Now we'll go through the steps for multiple regression. And for this example, we're going to be interested in whether or not the number of hours students study predicts their exam grade, controlling for their attendance. Right, so that's the overall research hypothesis. So we're hoping to find that studying does predict exam grades once you control for attendance. So first we'll go through the null hypothesis, and for multiple regression there's actually multiple null hypotheses. So these are the unstandardized coefficients here. And so what this says is the intercept is zero. This one says the slope for the number of hours you study is zero once you control for attendance. And this one says that the slope for attendance is zero when you control for the number of hours you study. Right? And so we could also write the standardized versions of these. Beta 1 equals 0. Beta 2 equals 0. And these are the exact same thing. In fact, these are going to have the same p-values and everything. And when we're doing a project like this, or when we have this kind of research question where we want to see if the hours of studying still predicts the outcome variable controlling for another one, this is the actual null hypotheses that we're more interested in, because we don't care about that intercept. All right, so next we will draw the population distribution. All right, so these are the population distributions if the null hypothesis is true, right? This is where we'll get our samples. If these null hypotheses are true, so we'll put exam grade over here and hours studying down here. And for these to be unrelated, right, that's a correlation of zero. It looks something like that. And this is the correlation between these two, or the relationship, controlling for attendance, right? And this is going to be exam grade control with attendance on the bottom. And if the null hypothesis is true, these are unrelated. And this is when you control for number of hours studying. All right, so if our null hypothesis is true, then both variables are, if both of our null hypotheses are true, then both of our variables are unrelated to exam grade, controlling for the other variable. All right, so that's our population distribution. We could draw our observed sample. So I put that down here. This is our observed sample. And again, we're going to have exam grade. This is going to be a scatter plot. Exam grade here. And we'll have hours studying down here. And let's say what we end up with is a scatter plot that looks kind of like this. There's also this, and so these are levels of attendance, and so we'll say if the dot is red, attendance was high, and for the black color, these are people whose attendance was low, right? And so if this is what our data looks like, you can actually interpret it a little bit here. So for when attendance is high, there's a positive correlation between hour studying and exam grade. And when attendance is low, that same relationship is there. So there's going to be a relationship between hour studying and exam grade if this is what the data looks like. Also notice that at every level of hour studying, people with higher attendance had a little bit of a higher grade. So that means attendance is also going to be related to exam grade when you control for hour studying. All right, so now step number four is drawing the sampling distributions. All And these are going to be the same as they were for simple regression, basically, just like these are. This is the null hypothesis, sampling distributions, and these are frequency distributions. In fact, we could do a third one if we wanted to for the intercept. I'll just hand draw this one. And so let's say this is, for our studying this, it will say that's B1, that's the slope for our studying. If the null hypothesis is true, and we get lots of samples, and we'll set our sample size to, we'll say it's 20. There should be 20 dots here, right? We have 20 students that we've observed. All right, if we take 20 random dots from this population and we calculate their slope, if there's no relationship, the most common observed slope will be zero, but every now and then we'll get a negative correlation. Every now and then we'll get a positive correlation. And this is actually a T distribution, like it was for a t-test. This will be the sampling distribution for the slopes of attendance, and it's going to be the same as this, zero in the middle, and every now and then you'd randomly get a positive value for your slope, a positive correlation. Every now and then you get a negative correlation for your slope, so a negative B. And remember, this is the expected slopes controlling for attendance, and this is the expected slopes for attendance controlling for our studying. And this is our intercept, and it's going to look exactly the same. It's also a T distribution centered around zero because our null hypothesis was that the slope, or that the intercept is zero. And so this time I drew these as scatter plots, but you can also draw them like I did for simple regression, just as a flat regression line that's actually centered on zero here. And remember, this would be normally distributed. So these are equivalent ways of thinking about it. And then if we talk a little bit more about these distributions, right? So this distribution will have a standard error. This distribution will have a standard error. And this distribution will have a standard error, right? Their standard deviation. And it turns out that to calculate the T, the formula is pretty easy. So T equals the slope divided by its standard error. And that'll be true for all three of these. So I could even say that this is the T for the variable number one, standard error one, variable number two, and then the T value for the intercept is the value for the intercept divided by its standard error. All right, next we draw, or we determine our critical region. And as usual, what we're going to want to use is an alpha of 0.05, and we're going to want to do two-tailed tests. All right, so we can draw our critical regions on these distributions. It's going to be where 0.025 is on each side, and that'll be true for all of these. Next, we're taking our alpha and splitting it across both tails. And we could actually determine our T critical pretty easily. So we just need to calculate, need the degrees of freedom. And our degrees of freedom here is N minus the number of parameters that we're estimating. The number of parameters is three. There's B1, B2, and A. Those are the three parameters we're estimating. So it's going to be our sample size of 20 minus the three parameters, and that'll give us 17 degrees of freedom. And if you look at your t-table with 17 degrees of freedom, t-critical is going to be plus or minus 2.11. So over here, this is 2.11 standard deviations over for each of those. Although in practice, you don't compare your t-statistic with a t-critical when you're using multiple regression. All right, next, we calculate our test statistics. So one way you can calculate these is SPSS will tell you your slopes and your intercept, and it'll tell you the standard error. So you could calculate your t-statistic that way, but SPSS will actually just tell you the t-statistic directly, so you don't even need to calculate it. And the actual calculations to determine all of these things are quite complicated, and they use matrix algebra. And how to do that is quite beyond the scope of this class. So we'll just leave it where it is for now and move on to deciding to reject the null hypothesis or not. All right, and so maybe what I'll do now is I'll kind of draw a little bit of what the output would look like for SPSS. So it would have, it'd tell you what the A value is, right? And we said that it's 20. So this is the slope for hours. And we said that was 6. And the slope for attendance was 1. Right, and it also have the p-values for each of these. And let's say we get something like .001, .001, and .010. Right, when we're deciding to reject the null hypothesis or not, with multiple regression, usually what you do is you just compare your p-value with alpha, and if your p-value is smaller than alpha, then you reject the null hypothesis for each of these separately. And if your p-value is larger than alpha, you fail to reject. So given this set of results, we reject the null hypothesis that the intercept is 0, which we don't care about. We reject the null hypothesis that hours setting is unrelated to exam grade, controlling for attendance. And so that was what we were hoping to find initially. So that's great. And here we also find that attendance predicts exam grade, controlling for number of hours people study, because our p-value is less than our alpha of 0.05. Right? And it would also be the case that SPSS will tell you your standardized coefficients. And we said those are .8 and .4. Right, and so these will have the exact same p-values as these. So you actually only get one set of p-values that applies to both of these. And so we could interpret these such that here hours of studying predicts exam grades, controlling for attendance with a correlation. It's kind of like a correlation of .8, whereas attendance predicts exam grades, controlling for number of hours you study, with a correlation of .4. Right, and you can see that the hours you study is more important than your attendance given this data. All right, and then you interpret your results next. All right, so I already did that to some degree, right? So this is what your results look like. Hours of studying predicts exam grade, controlling for attendance, just like we were hoping. And attendance predicts exam grades, controlling for the number of hours you studied, but we don't actually care too much about that in this case. And we don't care at all about the intercept being significant in this case, and usually we don't. Really, we're gonna focus usually on this part here. So if this is what our research study was like, when we're interpreting our results, what we would write in our research report, our paper that we write up, would be something like hours studying predicted exam grades when controlling attendance, or when taking attendance into account, or whatever language you want to use, right? So this is the main finding. This is what we were hoping to find, and in this case, we did find it. Let's say we did this, but instead, our p-value here was .09, right? So now, this is greater than alpha, and here we can't reject the null hypothesis. There, our interpretation would be something like hours studying did not predict or failed to predict exam grade controlling for attendance. And that's what we would have interpreted our results to mean. So you're less likely to say that it's inconclusive and more likely to just say that it didn't predict. Although truly the results are inconclusive because in reality there still could be a relationship between our studying and exam grade, and we just might not have had enough statistical power to detect that relationship. And so this particular interpretation I just gave you was about controlling for third variables, or are the main relationship held when controlling for a third variable. Another kind of interpretation, again, that would be common. This is the most common kind of interpretation, right? But remember, I said before that another kind of interpretation we might have is a mediation kind of interpretation. And let's say that this is the kind of results where hours of homework no longer predicts exam grade when you control for attendance. That could have been results supporting a mediation research hypothesis that suggested that maybe it's attendance that mediates the relationship that's observed between hours studying and exam grade. So this would be another kind of interpretation that would be pretty common. And the least common kind of research question you'd have is just merely having multiple predictors just trying to predict the actual outcome variable, right? And there, what we'd care about is these values. And what we would do is we'd put them into a prediction equation, and we would, whenever a new person would show up, we take their observed hours studied, their attendance, we'd plug those in, and we'd actually predict their exam grade. So that's something that does happen, probably more in like applied settings, like an IO psychologist, somebody who's working in the business world. But for a research scientist like me, usually we just care about whether or not relationships hold controlling for other explanatory variables. And another part of interpreting a multiple regression is its effect size. And I'm not going to talk too much about that now, but the effect size in a multiple regression, it's called multiple R squared, right? And so this is just like a correlation coefficient squared, but in this case what it is your outcome variable, exam grade, and it's how much of the variability in your outcome variable is explained by all of your predictors. So multiple R has a maximum of 1 if all of your outcome variables variation is explained by their predictors, and a minimum of 0 if your predictors are completely unrelated to your outcome variable. But we'll talk more about multiple R in a little bit.